Buitenland dan nu. Sean Richard liep op 14-jarige leeftijd al rond met een pistool op zak. En hij was de leider van een drugsdealende bende in San Francisco. Zijn verhaal is karakteristiek voor het zware leven van zwarte jongeren in de ghetto's van deze Amerikaanse stad. Tientallen jonge mensen sterven er jaarlijks door kogels. En een van hen was de broer van Sean. Sean stapte uit de bende en begon de organisatie Brothers Against Guns. Deze organisatie biedt de jonge gangleden een alternatief, in de hoop dat ze het leven van wapens en drugs achter zich laten.
I've been shot 15 times. I was shot once in my foot, twice in the leg, three times in the chest, three times in the back. Three bullets went to my liver. And that's why I have a liver, that's why I have a liver drainage. And I had to get surgery to get the bullets out. And they was only able to get three of them out, and that was the three of my liver. So I had 12 bullets left in me. So it's gonna be hard when I go through metal detectors and all that.
Dwayne Larry woont in Bayview. Hij is 25 jaar oud. Hij heeft geluk gehad, want hij leeft nog. Bayview is een buitenwijk van San Francisco, een ghetto. Bewoners zijn er hun leven niet zeker. Jongeren in deze wijk verwachten niet veel ouder te worden dan 25 jaar. Ze groeien op in gangs. Deze gangs maken de dienst uit in de wijken. In deze straten van sociale woningbouw schuilt ellende en geweld. Mensen leven er op of onder het bestaansminimum. De rust die er heerst, kan ieder moment verstoord worden. Weer iemand vermoord in Bayview. Al jaren vechten jeugdbendes hier een zinloze oorlog uit. Deze beelden zijn opgenomen door een jongen die in de ghetto woont. Hij heeft zijn wapen geruild voor een camera.
Hey, don't snatch no tape out of my hand.
Hey, don't touch me,
you know what? Don't snatch no tape out of my hand.
Devin Melvin is 16 jaar oud. Op zijn 12e liep hij al rond met een pistool. Nu loopt hij gewapend met een camera rond en registreert het leven in de ghetto. Devin wil de ghetto uit. Hij wil niets meer te maken hebben met de gangs en hun oorlog.
I've seen a lot of things like such as like from people getting killed, from people getting robbed, from me robbing people. I done been through a lot. I done seen a lot. I experienced so much in my neighborhood to where the point where I'm like, feel me, I want to do right. I lost two friends in 2005 named Jarrell and Wagga. They were both killed by gun violence. Man, it goes from way back. I couldn't even tell you because I probably wasn't even born when they start beefing. It's just something I'm in it by force.
Back to back. Back to back. These kids are contained in their own areas like animals. This herd is here. This herd is here, and this pack is here. This pack is here. We on the grind
and the cuts going fast. It's more or less an image like I got a gun, I'm bad, you know. I'm gonna shoot you, I don't have time to fight. We on the grind and the cuts
going sack to sack. And if you really some of the kids are just scared, you know, and they just want to fit in. They just want to be a part of something.
We actually have kids that they don't think they're going to live past 21 or 25 years old. So they're going to get all they can and do all they can while they can.
We're kind of doomed from the beginning, you know, being black, we're doomed.
Er zijn een paar initiatieven om jongeren die uit de gangs willen de helpende hand te bieden. Sean Richard zat vroeger in een gang. Tegenwoordig probeert hij jongeren te redden met zijn organisatie Brothers Against Guns. Hun doel is om jongeren uit de gevangenis te houden en voor te bereiden op een baan. Een nobel streven.
Hey Rose!
Volgens de statistieken verdwijnt in de Verenigde Staten 1/3 van de zwarte mensen voor hun 25ste jaar achter de tralies. En dit is de motivatie voor Sean. Deze mensen zijn slachtoffer in de gangoorlog. Eén van hen was zijn kleine broertje Tracy.
I'm trying to save lives. You know what I'm saying? I know cats been on y'all line and I know y'all been on other cats line. So now it's time for motherfuckers to just squash that shit and let's be for real about it and let's save some lives. That's my little brother, man. You know what I'm saying? And he gone. You know what I'm saying? That's why I started this program. I didn't start it for no other reason but my little brother.
What woke me up is when my brother got killed. Affected me in a major way, man. It opened up my eyes, man. It made me realize what I was dealing with and what I was becoming. And that I was I'm part of the reason why he's dead. Because he was trying to look up to me, pattern after me, follow after me. When I first seen a shooting, man, I was about 9 years old, coming home from school one day. This is an elementary school, man. You know what I'm saying? These kids used to be right smack in the middle of shootouts. Man, I had a good childhood, man. I ain't gonna lie. You know, I had everything I wanted as a kid. You know, my mother and father bust their butt to give me what they wanted, man. I wanted more. And that's how it all began. You know, you start off, you know what I'm saying? You start off hustling, and then you start off making a few dollars, and then you start off making more dollars, and then you start off getting more and more, and you get greedy with it, and it becomes like something you need. It's like you using a drug, but you're not using the drug because you're addicted to the money. Right here. That's where I grew up at.
Sean bezoekt zijn moeder regelmatig.
What's up, mom?
Oh, hi.
What's up?
Oh, how you doing?
Good. What's going on?
How you doing?
She was doing things that she wasn't supposed to do and behind my back, and I didn't know it, you know. And I was really hurt, you know, because I never wanted him to be in that, you know, that kind of environment or that kind of life, you know. And he really hurted me a lot. And I put him out when I found out, you know, you have to go.
Well, I mean, you know, obviously, you know, anybody that get put out their house where they grew up at, you know, they're going to be angry about it. But, I mean, she didn't want me here no more. So I decided, I said, okay, fine, I'm gone. And, I mean, I slept in my car for a couple of days. Then my auntie took me in when I graduated from high school. You know, I was hustling and carrying a gun on the streets and stuff. And so basically, you know, that wasn't what she wanted in our household.
You know, and I just pray and ask these kids to think twice before they pull a gun on anybody's babies. Think about it. Because you're not just hurting, you're not hurting the guy, you're hurting the family. We're the one have to be left to grieve and feel that pain. So just think about it before you do it. And God bless all the kids.
Devin is een van de voormalig gangleden die dankzij de organisatie van Sean een beter leven heeft. Hij heeft nu een baan in het museum en een vriendin. Zijn leven is nu rustiger. Tot voor kort zat hij veelvuldig in de jeugdgevangenis.
Probation got me to where I am today. For real. I wouldn't say juvenile. Juvenile just made me stress and punch walls and shit like that. But when I got out was really when it happened. When I got out and really got on probation and then got that job, I feel hopeless without a job. If I feel I have no income, I feel hopeless. I feel I have nothing.
I don't really see this part of town too much because I'm so trapped in on the other side where I'm usually be at. I don't really get around too much out of my neighborhood.
Transportation, getting around, getting out of the neighborhood is fun for me, living. But when I'm in the neighborhood, there's no fun, there's no laughing jokes. It could be on the outside, but deep down inside, I know I can get shot or killed or something can happen to me any time of the day when I'm up on that hill.
I'm always scared. Like, if I don't hear from him, I always think the first thing, like, something happened to him, because I know a lot of stuff out there and a lot of people, like, want them, so, like, I'm always scared, and that's why I'm happy I got a car to take places.
In my neighborhood, it's young niggas that's carrying pistols. It's young teenagers, 14 and under. From 12 on up, is holding pistols in my neighborhood. That's all I can speak for, because that's what I'm seeing every day.
Bij dit mediaproject monteert Devin het beeldmateriaal dat hij met zijn camera maakt.
I'm trying to make something out of my community. Like, I'm trying to, you know what I'm saying, do something that's going to help me and my community. And basically telling my story.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Only time I really carried a pistol was when I had some anger on my chest, when I really felt fear, when I felt scared to go places. Like, I still feel kind of scared to go places, but now I'm just smart. I think twice now. Back then, I really didn't think twice about it. I just did it because that was the only safe way of me getting to where I had to go. I was 12 years old, and then I got took to jail, I went to juvenile when I was 14. It's life, so I gotta deal with it. But I don't really trust nobody I be around for real, because I know somebody can turn on you any day, any second. So I try to tell the people I be around what I know. So they call me, they don't call me the preacher of the crowd, but they in words, they do put it like that, because I'm always talking. I'm always speaking about how we need to get money and stop beefing, you know what I'm talking about? We need to do, you know, stop living all this negativity, because we're living too much negativity right now. Selling dope, selling weed, using drugs, using this, playing people, jumping people, kicking people ass, all that shit, it's all wrong.
I see it.
Doordat Devin vroeger bij een gang hoorde en nog steeds in de buurt woont, kan hij met zijn camera indringende beelden maken. De naakte waarheid van het leven in een ghetto. Brothers Against Guns organiseert allerlei sociale evenementen om in contact te komen met jongeren. Vandaag een basketbalwedstrijd. In gesprekken proberen ze jongeren naar hun lessen te krijgen. In deze lessen worden ze in 3 maanden tijd voorbereid op de arbeidsmarkt. De eerste stap om uit de uitzichtloze situatie van de ghetto te komen. De lessen worden gegeven in het gemeentehuis. Neutraal terrein voor alle verschillende gangs. En bovendien hebben ze hier metaaldetectors bij de ingang. Want je weet met deze jongeren namelijk maar nooit. Na 3 maanden krijgen ze hun diploma en zijn ze klaar voor de arbeidsmarkt.
The main thing I learned, man, was to beat the streets, man. That's it. Beat the streets, man.
They gave us too much, they couldn't give us no more. We could have got more, but they, you know, it was too much. It was enough, basically. Enough to help us get through what we got to do and teach us about life.
The most important thing I learned, success. You must be successful in life. And it's determination and your willpower.
Optimistische woorden. 6 maanden na deze groepsfoto zitten 3 van deze jongens alweer achter tralies. Lee heeft zijn baan 4 maanden weten te behouden. Dwayne ligt in het ziekenhuis. Hij heeft 12 kogels in zijn lijf. En Archides is op dezelfde dag, vlak na het maken van de groepsfoto, doodgeschoten op straat.
En daarmee eindigt 1 Vandaag. Hier gaat straks het Sportjournaal verder. Nog een prettige avond.